I get my TV licence from the post office. It's just down the road. There's no way I'd ever miss an episode of Hamish Macbeth.
My television licence? I used to post off for it. And that's direct debit. It's all the rage these days.
I pay for my television licence by saving about £8 a month in stamps from this lovely young man.
I pay for my TV licence using monthly direct debit. It's so easy. Out of Thomas, please, mate.
There are many ways to pay for your TV licence. For details of monthly, quarterly or annual direct debit, please call 0990 50 20 30. That's 0990 50 20 30.
The island of Hong Kong. For 99 years, it's been a borrowed time and a borrowed place.
It is a slightly unique place. It isn't China and it isn't Britain. It is our home.
I think we're totally bicultural. And that, I think, is a very important aspect of what makes Hong Kong tick.
As the clock counts down, join us for its final hours as a British colony. Hong Kong Handover, live throughout the day, Monday on BBC One.
It's the Fast Show on BBC Two, shortly kicking off a special comedy zone in place of the tennis. At 9.30, Vic and Bob are shooting stars, including Noddy Holder and Chris Rea. And then at 10 o'clock, it's another trip to the movies for French and Saunders. Here on BBC One, in half an hour, the Drovers finally reach London. But will the streets really be paved with gold? Before that, on BBC One, the 9 o'clock news with Peter Sissons.
The governor of Hong Kong has condemned China for planning a show of force only hours after next week's handover. But as Britain holds the first of its emotional farewells, it's accused by the new regime of overreacting. The American agent who could be paid £9 million if he finds the right millennium sponsors. And sodden, muddied and miserable. And the water companies say we need more of it. Good evening. The Governor of Hong Kong, Chris Patten, has complained bitterly about China's plans to deploy a substantial military force in the colony next Tuesday within hours of the handover. 4,000 Chinese troops, backed by armoured vehicles, helicopters and warships, will move into position at first light. The Chinese claimed it was a smaller garrison than Britain usually deployed. But Mr. Patten, heavily involved now in a programme of nostalgic farewells, said the Chinese plan sent an appalling signal to the people of Hong Kong. Our Asia correspondent Fergal Keane reports.
A swan song for empire on a night when any pretense of harmony between Britain and China disappeared. The British conductor Barry Knight leading the Hong Kong Sinfonietta in an unabashed celebration of a colonial heritage Beijing is anxious to be rid of. This last night at the proms in Hong Kong was the first big celebration of the handover. But with news of China's decision to send armoured cars and gunships into Hong Kong fresh in his mind, Hong Kong's last governor was in defiant mood.
I can understand why the Chinese want a proper garrison here, but I don't think that it's at all a good idea to bring in 21 armoured cars at 6 o'clock on the 1st of July. In fact, I think it's a thoroughly bad idea, and I hope they'll reconsider it.
This recent film, taken inside a PLA camp, shows soldiers of the future Hong Kong garrison carrying out bayonet practice. Britain and the colony's democracy lobby have known for some time that large numbers of these troops would be deployed in Hong Kong. But the British and the Democrats never wanted armoured vehicles to come rumbling across the border on July the 1st. It's the memory of what this army did to unarmed demonstrators in Beijing in 1989 that provoked such unease here.
We don't need so many, and we don't need them coming in such a fashion, you know, by air, by land, by sea. Come on! I mean, the Hong Kong people are quite worried about the PLA. Why try to stir up these feelings?
The deployment of the troops and armoured cars won't alter the political situation in Hong Kong, and there are many pro-China figures who'll welcome them. Beijing says they're Hong Kong's protectors and is sure to react scornfully to Governor Patton's remarks.
It's not coming as any sort of surprise, and I really don't know why Governor Patton wants to paint them in such a negative light.
Just across the border in China, the streets are being prepared for a huge celebration. In recent days, the level of anti-colonial rhetoric, the talk of British oppression and Chinese humiliation has been relentless. This child said the imperialists invaded Hong Kong, now it's being returned. We're all happy. But tonight, the man denounced by China as the arch-imperialist was among supporters. Mr. Patton is a politician of conviction, but he also has a very keen sense of public relations. He knows that in these last days of empire, he must be seen to stand up to China. In less than 4 days, Mr. Patton and the British will be gone. Then the people of Hong Kong will have to make their own adjustment to a new reality. For the last governor, emotional times.
Tonight there is here a mood of celebration in spite of the Chinese action earlier in the day. For Chris Patton clearly believes that his democratic reforms will long outlast the guns of Beijing. Fergal Keane, BBC News, at the last night of the proms in Hong Kong.
And later in the news, we'll be reporting from Taiwan, which split with mainland China 50 years ago, and whose people are following the Hong Kong handover with particular interest. Here, the sports agent Mark McCormack is to be paid about £9 million commission in return for raising £150 million for the Millennium celebrations. The deal was announced after earlier reports that his IMG company could get as much as £30 million. Conservatives accused Labour, who often condemned fat cats, of double standards. Our political correspondent Nicholas Jones reports.
Mark McCormack, the international sports agent, has a race on his hands if he's to get more in sponsorship than was raised for either the last World Cup or the Olympics. Most of the money for the Millennium Experience is coming from the lottery, but another £150 million is needed from the business world.
It's a tall order that Mark McCormack and his company have to meet. A lot of money, many goods and services have got to be pulled in from the private sector in just over a year or 18 months. I'm confident they'll do it, but they will only get any money from us when they have delivered. In the meantime, they won't be getting a penny.
Transforming the Greenwich site into the Millennium Dome has already pulled in a few backers, like British Airways and British Telecom, but industry insiders think that selling an unknown quantity won't be easy.
It's not as if it's like Wimbledon or the Olympics, which has a huge amount of TV coverage, which you can sell a lot of the rights through the TV coverage. This is a really difficult project. It's a great project, so you need the best fundraisers in the world. They don't come cheap.
But the willingness of the government to pay out as much as £9 million in commission is worrying some Labour backbenchers.
I hope that what I heard this morning about a particular individual likely to make a huge fortune out of the Millennium at Greenwich, I hope the Minister of Sport does feel that that might not be the best way to move the Millennium Project forward.
The government's decision to sign up a sponsorship company is seen by the Conservatives as a timely recognition of commercial reality.
It's rank hypocrisy for Labour to criticise fat cat directors for getting high pay levels when they themselves are discovering in the real world that that's what you have to do. They are in the same position as shareholders of Camelot and shareholders of utilities. They want the results, they're discovering you have to pay for it.
The stakes are getting higher all the time over the funding of the Millennium Experience. Tony Blair has now put his credibility on the line in hoping that an agent will raise the millions that are needed and that the business community will pick up the bill. Nicholas Jones, BBC News, Westminster.
In his first major speech as Conservative leader, William Hague has appealed to Scottish Conservatives for unity. He also called for a referendum on the European Union treaty signed in Amsterdam last week. The speech at the Scottish Conservatives conference in Perth is part of a campaign to revive their fortunes in Scotland, where they lost all their MPs at the general election. Our Scotland political editor Brian Taylor reports.
Hello. Hello.
How are you?
Welcome to Perth.
Thank you very much.
The conference over, William Hague pursued his plan to consult the party, in this case at a Tory agent's reception. Luck has deserted the Scottish party of late. The election left them without a single seat. William Hague now has to put the pieces together again. In advance, there were offstage nerves because the run-up to the conference featured factional infighting and personal insult among sections of the Scottish party. The leadership voiced their impatience with dissent.
To those who wish to engage in such childish antics, my message is clear. Grow up, get in line, or get out.
In the event, little public dissent emerged, but Mr. Hague broadened the warning into a demand for unity.
The days of disunity, of factions and wings, of groups within groups, of parties within parties, of cliques within cliques, must now be over. That's finished. That's done with. That's out. As long
some in the party had argued that the Tories should heed apparent Scottish opinion and endorse or at least tolerate the government's plan for a devolved Scottish Parliament. But the conference overwhelmingly urged Scots to vote against a Scottish Parliament and against devolved tax powers in the planned referendum.
So Conservatives will call upon the Scottish people to oppose the creation of a Scottish Parliament in the referendum, and we will urge them to vote no, no.
More generally, he challenged the government to hold a further referendum on the revised European Union treaties agreed at the Amsterdam summit.
Amsterdam was a bad treaty. It was bad for Europe, it was bad for Britain, and the Labour government signed up to it lock, stock and barrel.
Some Tories had been hoping for an instant shake-up of the Scottish party, perhaps involving a directly elected leader. But William Hague is said to want time to consider. A commission of the great and the good will examine options, but privately it's expected to work on the assumption that a Scottish Parliament will be established and that the Scottish Tories will have to work with it. Brian Taylor, BBC News, Perth.
Talks aimed at preventing confrontation at the Drumcree Orange Order march in 9 days' time have ended without agreement. Representatives from the Orange Order and from Portadown's nationalist Garvaghy Road estate stayed in separate rooms throughout the session at Hillsborough Castle near Belfast, with government officials liaising between them.
In Hillsborough's main street, an orange arch, a loyalist tradition carrying the symbols of the orders and commemorating past battles. Tonight there's a band parade under the red, white and blue bunting, a celebration of the Protestant Unionist culture and tradition. No controversy in this mainly Protestant village. But just up the road at the Northern Ireland Secretary's official residence, Orange Order leaders and local Catholics from Portadown tried to thrash out an agreement on that most bitterly controversial of parades, Drumcree, without talking to each other. The two sides met under one roof, but never sat in the same room. The RUC Chief Constable, Ronnie Flanagan, was there, to be called on if needed. He's helped conciliate other marches in the past. And the members of the newly set up Parades Commission, though they still haven't yet got the legal powers planned for them. After 6 hours of shuttle diplomacy, all the legwork was done by Mo Molum and her security director, John Steele, it was announced by all sides that no agreement had been reached. But the Northern Ireland Secretary was adamant that didn't represent a breakdown.
I called the talks to an end for the simple reason that I thought we'd gone over the issues during the day. We had a number of suggestions from both sides, and I want a chance to think about those and then go back and talk in bilaterals next week. So it's not a breakdown, it's part of an ongoing process. That's what's been going on.
Resolution still possible.
As I say, I never give up hope.
The residents and the Orange Order issued statements. The Orangemen said they'd put forward responsible and accommodating principles, but the Catholics were still angry that the Loyalists flatly refused to meet them.
We had useful and constructive exchanges during the course of the day with the Secretary of State. Unfortunately, the Orange Order were not willing to pursue a similar path with us directly. The Residents' Coalition wishes to sit down with Portadown Orange men and find a lasting and just resolution to the Parade's dispute.
Mo Molam's bold initiative, but the two sides' positions still seem irreconcilable. Dennis Murray, BBC News, Hillsborough.
The chief executive of British Airways, Robert Ayling, has told the 9 o'clock news that there are no plans to turn the company into a virtual airline, where most services are contracted out to other companies. BA ground staff have been voting on whether to take strike action over the company's plans to sell off its in-flight catering business. Our business correspondent Greg Wood reports.
Passengers checking in for tonight's Concorde flight from Heathrow. The staff here are part of a 60,000-strong workforce employed directly by British Airways. But staff at the airline's in-flight catering business will soon find themselves working for a new employer. BA is selling the business. It's been accused of moving towards a so-called virtual airline, where more and more functions are contracted out. BA denies the charge.
I haven't the faintest idea what a virtual airline is. We have looked at just about every aspect of what we do to see whether we can make it efficient inside or whether we should dispose of it and put it in the hands of somebody else. And for the time being, I think we've looked at and taken decisions about just about everything we would want to.
Take the following details to the check-in deck.
But the virtual airline already exists. This is EasyJet at Luton Airport. The people here taking bookings over the phone are self-employed, earning 80 pence commission for each seat sold.
We decided that really running an airline is about selling the seats and serving the customers. All the other activities can be cost-effectively and efficiently subcontracted out.
EasyJet uses ground staff and catering provided by outside contractors. It issues no tickets. Passengers get a reusable plastic boarding card. For its first 6 months of operation, even the plane's pilots and cabin crew were leased. Contracting out is a growing trend among companies.
Thanks a lot.
British Airways is not going to end up like EasyJet, except on a larger scale. But the idea of the virtual airline is forcing global carriers to change the way they run their businesses. Greg Wood, BBC News, Luton Airport.
Official figures released today show economic growth in recent years has been much faster than had been thought. Some economists believe this makes it more likely the Chancellor will decide to put up taxes in his budget next week. The revised figures for gross domestic product suggest the economy is nearer to full capacity than earlier estimates had suggested. Police in Greater Manchester have been searching a country park in Blakely for the body of an 8-year-old boy who disappeared 7 weeks ago. Officers acting on a tip-off believe that Jamie Lavis may have been murdered and buried in the area. The government has blocked the proposed merger that would have created Britain's biggest brewing company. The president of the Board of Trade, Margaret Beckett, said the deal between Bass and Carlsberg Tetley would have operated against the public interest. The people of Albania will be voting on Sunday in a general election many hope will end months of turmoil for Europe's poorest country. The leading international observer there for the election has said the situation in some parts of the country is precarious. Albania's recent troubles began with the collapse of several pyramid investment schemes last November. In the south, people who lost their savings began a rebellion against the government of President Sali Berisha. In March, he declared a state of emergency, and a few days later agreed to new elections. Our Southern Europe correspondent Orla Gehrin reports for the 9 o'clock news from the capital, Tirana.
Election campaigning Albanian style. Armed gunmen in place of public relations people. President Berisha can't leave town without this kind of protection. When gunfire interrupted the president's speech, his men didn't hesitate. With casualties among the crowd, the president and his men made a quick getaway. There's nothing normal about this election. Ballot boxes arrived here under armed guard. Election observers, too, have to be protected. But there are parts of the country where they just can't go. It's too risky. The OSCE admits it's imperfect, but says the Albanian election is its worst nightmare.
Well, so far from the experience of OSCE and my own experience, this is one of the most complicated and difficult mandates that have ever been followed by OSCE countries. And I think and I hope that we will have contributed to a solution. And I also think and hope that there aren't many more cases of this nature.
Behaving like a man who thinks he's already won, the Socialist Party leader, Fatos Nano. He's been drawing the crowds in Tirana. Others aren't so sure he'd beat President Berisha's Democratic Party, but when we met, he was predicting a massive opposition victory.
Absolutely, one of out of two votes would be in our favor. And basically, it's very possible that two-thirds of the future parliament will be controlled by the opposition in terms of political forces belonging to the spectrum from centre-left to centre-right.
The international community is determined this election goes ahead, flawed or otherwise. But there's no guarantee the result will be accepted by the defeated side. In this climate of violence, many here fear some bad losers. Orla Geeran, BBC News, Tirana, Albania.
There's been a huge increase in the number of women being sent to prison, according to a survey by the National Association of Probation Officers. It says that over the past 4 years, the number of female prisoners is up by 76%. That's more than twice the rate of increase for men.
At Style Prison in Cheshire, the women making shirts in this workshop may well be in custody unnecessarily, according to the Probation Officers Association. It says 4 years ago, many women in jail would have been given community sentences instead. The study found that women with no previous convictions were more likely to be imprisoned than men. One prisoner here believes she was treated harshly for a first offence of supplying cannabis.
The person who was in court before me was a bloke on the same charge as me, and he got probation. And then I went in after him and I got slammed down 2 years for the same thing.
Serious crime amongst women has actually dropped year on year for the last 5 or 6 years. But the prison population during that same period has shot up by 76%. The conclusion that we draw from that, less serious crime but more women inside, is a harsher sentencing climate.
In all of my, we was doing bingo, and whoever won the bingo was getting like 1 and 3 fags. You know?
At Crowley House Probation Hostel for Women in Birmingham, lunch isn't as crowded an affair as it used to be. There were once 5 referrals a day from the courts, but only 2 women have arrived in the last week. The rest are ending up in prison. Whether prisoners like these at Stile are in custody unnecessarily is something that the government's promising to address. The prison's minister today said she was concerned at the increase in the population and was looking at ways of making community sentences more effective. Jane Peel, BBC News.
Mission Control in Moscow has ordered the 3-man crew of the damaged space station Mir to rest because they're suffering from emotional and physical stress. Some of Mir's systems were turned off to save energy after an unmanned vessel crashed into it on Wednesday. Russia is sending a spaceship with equipment for an attempt at repairs. Back now to the preparations for the handover of Hong Kong to China on Monday. The people of Taiwan are following developments with particular interest. Beijing regards their island as a renegade province. But the leaders of Taiwan claim they're the legitimate government of China, a dispute that began at the end of the Chinese Civil War in 1949. Our Foreign Affairs editor John Simpson reports from Taiwan for the 9 o'clock news on how Beijing is trying to isolate the Taiwanese government.
It wasn't the subtlest of diplomatic messages. The Taiwanese insist that this week's war games have nothing to do with the handover of Hong Kong, but it's clear what they really mean. Hong Kong might soon be Chinese, but Taiwan won't be. Not that Taiwan really fears invasion. As President Lee Teng-hui toured his government's latest acquisitions, from American Patriot missiles to Mirage jets, and then on to radar-baffling French Lafayette frigates, they were far better than anything the mainland Chinese possess. But it's China's economic and diplomatic muscle the Taiwanese have to worry about now. The military threat is history. That belongs to the days of Chiang Kai-shek, the nationalist Chinese leader whose waxwork sits in his reconstructed office and who founded the Taiwanese state in 1949 when the communists took over the mainland. For decades, the Americans protected Taiwan from China's claim over it. But although the guard at Chiang Kai-shek's memorial still goes through its traditional paces, the world is changing. In the last 3 years, China's economy has overtaken Taiwan's, and now its foreign reserves are higher too. Everyone wants to do business with China, and the Chinese play on that ruthlessly to isolate Taiwan. Only 34 countries now have diplomatic offices here, and most of them aren't called embassies.
Britain has a trade and cultural office here. The United States has the American Institute. France, Germany and Canada all have similarly discreet organizations. And the Japanese are the meekest of all. They have simply the Office of the Interchange Association, brackets Japan.
Panama in Central America has a full ambassador here, though, and the People's Republic of China has put ferocious pressure on his government back home as a result.
They send emissaries to Panama and say how absolutely intolerable for the PRC Panama's behavior is.
So in diplomatic terms, the Chinese are bullies.
Why should we be surprised? They bullied the Germans. They bully Britain all the time. They bully, if it suits them, Russia.
And America, Taiwan's traditional defender, too. The Taiwanese are increasingly learning to look after themselves, and their real defense is their economy. While Taiwan has the world's 12th highest rate of growth, its trading partners won't desert it, even if China is doing better.
If we do economic right, we have every right to deserve, survive, and do the system the way we want. And this will be the truth for people in Hong Kong, as well as Taiwan.
Still, after Hong Kong's handed over, the Taiwanese can expect the full force of China's determination to bring them in too. And China's tactics will be fiercer than ever. John Simpson, BBC News, Taiwan.
Manchester United have signed the England striker Teddy Sheringham from Tottenham Hotspur. The club paid £3.5 million for the 31-year-old. He'd asked for a transfer earlier this month, saying he wanted to play for a team that was regularly challenging for domestic trophies. Heavy rain has continued to cause chaos throughout the country. There was no play at Wimbledon for the second consecutive day, and the site for this weekend's Glastonbury Music Festival has turned to mud. Paul Newman reports.
Summer 97 on the south coast of England seems more like the middle of winter. There's been severe flooding in parts of Bognor Regis, with water several feet deep. As the heavy rain continues, the emergency services have been struggling to pump the water away. On the Lincolnshire coast at Skegness, temperatures only reached 10 degrees Celsius. The sunshine forecast proved a little optimistic, but some holidaymakers were not deterred.
I've got my own whiskey, rum and booze in the chalet, and not all, I'm quite happy.
It makes you think twice about coming to Britain.
I'm going abroad next year.
This house in Southampton was seriously damaged after a lightning strike caused part of the roof to cave in. The lightning travels straight through the electrical circuit before blowing out sockets.
This side of the lounge just blew up in my face, and the glass went everywhere and smoke coming from the stairs. And I ran outside and tried to get some help. I ran back in again.
Wimbledon was washed out for the second successive day, but it failed to put off the crowds who huddled under umbrellas and plastic mats.
It's already promising to be one of the wettest Wimbledons on record, with the organisers trying to work out how they can make up for lost time. The best they can hope for, it seems, is a change in the weather.
Conditions were even worse at Glastonbury and Somerset. The first day of the music festival was turned into a giant mud bath, with more wading than dancing. But the wettest June for 10 years has been welcomed in some quarters.
Whilst it's very, very welcome, and we're very sorry that people's holidays are being ruined, it's very welcome indeed, but we're going to need quite a lot of winter rainfall to help us through next year.
The prospect of more summer rainfall prompted these campers in Cornwall to head for home. The rain is expected to move north over the weekend towards Scotland and Northern Ireland, which have so far escaped the worst. Paul Newman, BBC News.
And the main news again tonight, the outgoing governor of Hong Kong, Chris Patten, has condemned China's decision to send 4,000 troops, backed up with armoured cars, into the colony just hours after the handover. Newsnight is on BBC Two at 10:30, but from the 9 o'clock news, good night, stay dry.
Good evening. Police in Manchester say there's now little chance of the missing 8-year-old schoolboy Jamie Lavis being found alive. Detectives have spent the day searching parkland at Boggatall Clough near Blakely after an anonymous telephone call which claimed he'd been buried there. Peter Marshall reports.
It's one of the largest operations ever launched by Greater Manchester Police. 100 officers took part, dog handling teams searched undergrowth and pathways, while underwater search teams checked ponds and streams. The sheer scale of resources, an indication of how seriously police are treating the new line of inquiry. Jamie disappeared almost 2 months ago. His family are being informed of all new developments.
They certainly accept that it's highly unlikely that Jamie would be found safe and well after this length of time. The conclusion thereafter, again a reasonable one, is that he's been murdered.
The phone call which led to today's search followed a television reconstruction of Jamie's last known movements.
Day one of this massive operation has so far uncovered nothing, and work is being scaled down for the night. But with 192 acres of parkland to cover, police say the search could well go on into next week.
The man heading the European Parliament's inquiry into BSE, or mad cow disease, has visited Cheshire to see controls operating in beef production. Farmers want him to recommend a lifting of the ban on British beef. Robin Anderson reports.
Cheshire is proud of its beef, the farming and the procedures to ensure meat is BSE-free. The problem is that's not the problem for the visiting MEP. His central concern is that the disease is out there at all. But at this abattoir in Huxley, they were doing their best.
British beef has always been safe, and it is now safer than ever. All precautions are being taken, and I'm hoping after this morning's visit that we shall now push on towards getting the export markets open.
However, though the MEP approved of what he was shown, he said the ban should stay.
It is almost automatic. Provided you have a certain level of epidemic, there is no possibility of exporting. So we have to struggle.
So stuck with the ban for a bit?
Well, exactly. I mean, the ban can only be lifted when the epidemic disappears. It is almost automatic, you know. So I think although the epidemic levels have gone down, still substantially, there still you have an epidemic.
He says the matter's now in the hands of the European Commission and its vets.
Police are investigating an attack on the home of a director of the Mersey Docks and Harbour Company. A lead weight was thrown through the lounge window of the Liverpool home belonging to marketing director Ken Wharton. It's the second attack on his home since the dockers' strike began 2 years ago. A lottery winner from Cheshire, whose ticket laid unclaimed for more than 2 months, has collected his prize. Solicitor Maurice Mogg from Nantwich won almost £2 million in the April the 9th draw. But his secretary, who buys his tickets, hadn't checked the numbers until this week. Good she did. Cricket and the weather stopped Derbyshire from playing today, and bad light stopped play at Worcester, where Lancashire were in action. Home side reached 58 for 4. Have a good weekend. Goodbye.
Well, no play at Wimbledon today, so BBC Two's in an impromptu comedy zone now with Noddy Holder, Chris Rea and Samantha Janus bravely joining the regulars for Shooting Stars.
Good evening. Well, heavy rain across England and Wales, but also across some other parts of Europe too. Thunderstorms across central areas and across towards Moscow. We've seen some very intense storms set off by some very high temperatures. You can see Moscow about 25 degrees. It's going to stay pretty hot across the whole of Eastern Europe. Not so in the west, though, across Spain and Portugal. Here, cool and showery. Now, it's that area of low pressure, of course, which has been with us for a day or two now, which has given the heavy rain. It's going to move slowly northwards and then back southwards over the next few days, gradually weakening all the time. So by Monday, probably many areas could be largely dry, the showers becoming fewer and farther between. But a lot of rain again today across East Anglia, Coldisall seeing 45 millimetres in 24 hours. At the moment, some of that rain has died away, but I think overnight, renewed rain coming in from the east, pushing its way westwards across northern England, eventually getting into North Wales, many parts of the Midlands, southern Scotland, and possibly even some parts of Northern Ireland. But everywhere, I think, a grey and misty end to the night, temperatures about 10 or 11 across many parts of the country. So a grey start to the day, except in, again, northwest Scotland, where it will be bright and dry for much of the day. The rain in southern Scotland and Northern Ireland probably easing away with a brighter afternoon, but across many northern parts of England, and particularly the northeast, it may stay grey and wet right through the afternoon. Now, a different sort of day across southeastern parts of England. Here I think we'll see some sunshine for a change, but that could set off some heavy and possibly thundery showers as temperatures peak about 18, possibly even 19 degrees. Also about 18 degrees in some sheltered parts of southern Scotland, sheltered from that still stiff northerly wind. Now, temperatures over the next couple of days are going to rise only very slowly, a little bit more sunshine coming through. So on Sunday, a bit of sunshine, but also a fair number of showers, and still probably rather cloudy through northern parts of England and western parts of Wales. By Monday, those showers fewer and farther between, and generally lighter too, temperatures a degree up. Perhaps northern Scotland, though, still rather cloudy, with some spells of just light rain. That's it from me. A very good night to you.
If you think that drugs are just about inner-city ghettos, think again. This is a story of a small and very normal valley in which 19 young people died in the space of 4 years.
I just asked him never to drug. He says, I won't, I promise I won't.
How much longer is this going to go on?
I was one of his parents that would say it would never happen to me. It has.
The deaths are predominantly linked to one drug, methadone. Panorama examines a drug handed out free as a less harmful alternative to heroin. Monday night at 10 on BBC One.
Peeled baby prawns recline on an emerald bed of chiffonade dipped in a delicately flavoured sauce mayonnaise. Is that prawn cocktail?
Yes, sir.
Three New Yorkers share a flat but never set eyes on each other. Well, that's the plan anyway. Matthew Broderick stars in our film premiere The Night We Never Met. That's at 10:25. First on BBC One, the Celtic Cowboys are on the final leg of their journey in Drover's Gold.
No.
I've been no good without you, Isabel.
I'm sorry for that. You had your chance.
Miss him, you know. Is he? Right. Flesh and blood, eh? I mean, my son.
Get out! You stay out of this, Daniel!
There's only one thing to be done with cattle thieves. Hang them from the nearest tree.
Look for you.
Me?
I was worried about you. When I had to kill one of the pigs, I used to run and hide in the cellar.
Father?